We're going back in time almost two decades to answer two questions. One is, can the 2004 Mazda RX-8 keep up with modern sports cars? And two, is it worth buying today? Let's find out. Buckle up and let's go for a drive. I'm your host, Brian Max, racing driver, lover of driving fast, fun things. And on this channel, you get reviews for drivers from drivers. Now, it is a blast to go back in time and revisit this RX-8 because I missed it. I never have driven one of these, not even a race car. So thanks to my pal Brian for lending me his sweet RX-8. And this is a very, very nice specimen. And he bought it well, as we will discover later in the episode. And if you'd like to have your car featured on our show, just let me know. Drop a comment, send me a message, send me an email, however you like, and we'll have a chat. Love to try some of your interesting rides. But this RX-8 is something else. It's almost 20 years old, so it's got a little bit of age on it. And before we get into what it's like to drive, let's have a look at this RX-8 in a little more depth. Yes, we know the RX-8 was the last of Mazda's rotaries, but I've actually never driven one, so let's have a look at these mechanicals. Under the hood is a twin rotor 1.3 liter, and here it's rightly paired with a 6-speed manual, so it's got the higher output, makes 238 horsepower at 8,500 RPM, and about 5 torques. No, I'm just kidding. It makes 159 pounds of torque at 5,500 RPM. When it's paired with a 4-speed automatic, it loses about 40 horsepower. And before some of you point out that there were some engine issues, yes, we know this. In 2008, Mazda extended the warranty to 8 years or 100,000 miles on this engine. It is, of course, rear-wheel drive, and there's a mechanical limited slip diff in the back. That's proper. Suspension is double wishbones front, multi-link at the rear, also proper. Steering is electrically assisted, which is interesting for a 2004. Four-wheel disc brakes, of course. Wheels and tires are 18s. No, they don't call those suicide doors. They call them freestyle doors. Curb weight of this RX-8 with the manual is about 3,050 pounds, a relative feather light in today's world. And static weight distribution is 48% front, 52% rear. But on this channel, we know it's not static weight distribution that counts. It's how you use it. Since this is a channel for drivers from drivers, we are always concerned about this driver interface. And this is a bit quirky, as a lot of things are with this RX-8. First of all, I'm seated a little too high off the floor. I should be 3 inches lower, but that's how Mazda designed this thing. And of course, these seats have airbags in them, so you have to take that into consideration. I would like to get significantly lower in this RX-8, that's for sure. That may be my only genuine complaint about the RX-8. After that, there's a decent interface to the steering wheel and the pedals, nice solid dead pedal to support you when the cornering gets serious. If I have a minor complaint, in fact, there's no reach in this steering wheel. It's only adjustable for height like the ND1 MX-5 was. They fixed that on the ND2 and there was a little bit of reach adjustment, but this has no reach adjustment whatsoever. After that, what we're living with is ergonomics that were designed over 20 years ago, and it's very, very vintage in terms of feel. There is indeed a CD player here, which is interesting. I haven't seen one of those since I drove a Lexus. And otherwise, it's pretty easy to live with this on a day-to-day basis, minus the big screen that would be here on a modern car. But what that means is you get a phone mount, and if you use Waze and Apple CarPlay like I do, well, you just mount your phone somewhere within sight, speak to Siri, and have it do its thing. And what's cool about our friend Brian's car here is that basically everything works because it's so well taken care of and it's got such little mileage on it. Philosophically, the ergonomics seem true to form for Mazda. It's very much oriented to the driver, very simple, straightforward. And, you know, 20 something years ago, there really wasn't that much to deal with. So ergonomics are very simple, easy to live with. And it's kind of easy to deal with this car even 20 years later. What I do find interesting, because I missed the RX-8, really never spent any time with one at all, never drove one, and I knew it had these freestyle doors. Don't call them suicide doors. But that rear seat space is kind of usable if you've got small kids or a dog like I do. No, my dog has not been in this car. But if I picked up one of these, I would definitely take my dog in this. It makes a lot of sense. But yeah, there's lots of storage. It's a decent amount of space. The cabin itself seems like it's scaled for 20 years ago. It's a little on the smaller side, and then the fact that I'm seated a little higher up than I want to be makes this cabin feel a little bit more cozy. Terms of performance, yeah, it's not a rocket ship. It does 0 to 60 in about 6 seconds, which is on par for the 86 and the MX-5. And, you know, that's okay. In the real world, it kind of works that way. But because it's a rotary, you really have to work this engine in a very, very different way. The thing about this kind of naturally aspirated rotary, there's no turbo here, it doesn't make any torque at all. It is all horsepower. It just is a completely different driving experience than anything else, especially modern cars. Even modern naturally aspirated cars, this thing has no torque whatsoever. However, it is incredibly rewarding to drive this all the way to redline and then just row through the gears. It's so much fun extracting all of the horsepower that you can out of this rotary. Trouble is, from time to time, say you're accelerating onto the highway and, you know, you might run out of a gear. When you shift to the next gear, well, it drops engine speed well down the rev range. There's no torque there, so you gotta work until it gets back up to peak horsepower, which is way up at the upper end, 8,500 RPM, and this thing will rev to 9,000, 9,500 RPM. It's an incredibly unique driving experience, especially in context of modern cars. This manual gearbox is just a joy to row. It's got great feel. The gates are well defined. Great feel out of this clutch. And, you know, again, well bought to our friend Brian. This car is really sorted. There's no issues with it whatsoever. It just works wonderfully well. There's more than enough traction here. I've never really overtaxed the rear tires under acceleration. So I think we've got the right amount of tire underneath us, given that this engine is basically stock. That mechanical limited slip diff does exactly what it's supposed to do. Works for me just fine. Makes carving corners that much more enjoyable, and putting down power on corner exit, spot on. There's great chassis balance as well, as we will get into. Oh, it's all horsepower. This is hilarious. What I love about this motor is that it's incredibly responsive to throttle inputs, making heel and toe like this an absolute joy. And of course, in a car from 2004, there is no rev matching like modern cars have. And I really wish they wouldn't do that, because more people need to learn how to heel and toe. And if you don't, we have an episode on this channel and I'll teach you how to do heel and toe. If you don't know what that is, links here, links below in the description. And it's very cool. If you drive a manual, you want to learn how to heel and toe. The responsiveness of the rotary engine and this throttle pedal makes heel and toe in this RX-8 an absolute breeze. And on top of that, it's not only easy, but it's a joy. Everything works so smoothly. It's so natural to me. And I love the fact that there is no rev matching. And being able to do this, being able to drive a car in this way, makes this very much a driver's car. And that's part of its charm. As I often discuss on this channel, Mazda builds cars for drivers, and it seems like they were doing that in 2004. The steering is electrically assisted, but it's got great heft, great on-center feel, does exactly what it's supposed to do. And, you know, this is a car that was engineered over 20 years ago, so kudos to Mazda for doing such a fine job sorting this car dynamically, starting with the steering, braking as well. We're not dealing with a sophisticated braking system here. These are just simple calipers, not, you know, four piston Brembos. Brake feel, control, modulation, spot on. Also speaks to how well this car was cared for, but it drives kind of like a new car, and I'm very happy with the brake pedal as well. It allows me to position this car perfectly on the brake pedal when I'm entering a corner. It's very much a driver's car in that way. And then, of course, when it comes to corner exit, the diff does its job. The steering is fantastic. So I've got great communication and great feel through this car as well, and that's one of the highlights. It's 3,000 pounds, so there's a lot of chassis feel here. I really can feel what each tire is doing and how it's in contact with the road. This is an incredibly refreshing driving experience. Yeah, we might be on 20-year-old dampers, and that's probably true, but the dampers do an okay job. What I do find, and this car is stock, but what I do find is that there's a little initial body roll when you turn into a corner, and then the car kind of takes a set after that. Once it's taken that set, it is very, very content. You really feel what's going on at each corner, so you've got a clear path to exiting the corner. This is just incredible. And of course, it's rear-wheel drive, so ultimately that gives this great poise, great balance, and you really have control over the attitude of this car. I'm impressed. For something that is from 2004, this just blows my mind. Given its power-to-weight ratio is just one step above the MX-5, you really can't get away with driving this flat out all the time. It's very easy to get this going to extra legal speeds, so you do have to mind what you're doing on the throttle, but yeah, it's just a little bit real world quicker than the MX-5, both back in 2004 as well as in 2023. And that's okay because it keeps up with a lot of traffic. Yes, there's a lot of quicker cars, but if you buy an RX-8 at the price point this one was purchased at, and we'll get into that in a minute, this is an incredible bargain. Regardless of whether it's a bargain or not, ride and handling is definitely on the 20-year-old side. There would be a little bit more refinement today. There's a little bit of crash through on road imperfections, a little bit more than I would have expected given the supple character of the suspension, because it's really on the softer side. And like Mazda does today with the MX-5, they really let the suspension work, and that's what they've done here with this RX-8. The suspension is allowed to work, which is a very good thing because it does communicate with you and it does what it's supposed to do. It's not overly stiff, doesn't skip over road imperfections, the tires stay in contact with the road, which is exactly what they're supposed to be doing. So I have to give props to Mazda back in the early 2000s when they were engineering this, because they engineered a setup that allowed the suspension to work. What we are dealing with is chassis construction from 20 plus years ago, or chassis engineering from 20 plus years ago. So that's a different thing. So perhaps that's why we're getting a little bit of this crash through, and it's a little rough on imperfect surfaces, but on a road surface like this, it's just a joy to drive, and both you and your passengers would be very happy here. It's not an overly stiff ride. It's definitely a sports car kind of setup, and it's still comfortable, it's still compliant, and then still a blast through the corners. This just makes funny sounds. Gotta love it. Just love that you gotta hunt for that horsepower. How do you spec yours? Well, normally at this point in the episode, it's a question of choosing the right options, but since you can't buy one of these new and you have to look at the used market, you're gonna be stuck with what's available. However, I've got some tips. As for buying used, you know the drill. Buy right. Make sure it's documented, it's got a full service history, hasn't been crashed, all of those sorts of things, in addition to getting a proper inspection. What you are looking at is a 2004 Lightning Yellow
RX-8 with the manual transmission, which is the only way you should get your RX-8. Nonetheless, at the time, this was about $30,000 US or $40,000 Canadian. These days, retail pricing for one of these looks to be about $14,000 US or $14,000 Canadian based on a cursory glance at the internet. However, our friend Brian picked this up a little while ago with about 25,000 miles on it for about $9,000 Canadian. So if you can find yourself with that kind of deal, well, a 2004 RX-8 might just be a bargain in your garage. My verdict? Well, we often start this segment with fuel consumption, and because this engine is notorious for its poor fuel consumption, we are going to find out. So I'm in the midst of calculating that. After we're done filming, I'm actually going to top it up, and we're going to see whether we're over or under my prediction, which is 15 miles per gallon in mixed city and highway driving. I've taken this for a bit of a drive to fully understand it, really enjoy the car, and as you know, I enjoy using the throttle. So my guess is I'm going to do worse than 15 miles per gallon, and we'll find out the truth in 3, 2, 1. Well, I lost that one. I seriously thought I was gonna do worse, especially the way I use the throttle, and this is a horsepower engine, so I'm always into the throttle, revving it up to redline, and it's a joy to do that, but I was expecting worse mileage, so good for this 19-year-old Mazda engine. To answer those two very important questions as to whether this RX-8 can keep up with modern sports cars and whether it's worth buying today, well, I think we answered the question already as to whether it's worth buying. If you can buy one as well as our friend Brian did, well, that's a no-brainer. As far as it keeping up with modern sports cars, well, this is close in terms of performance to a GR86, a BRZ, or even the MX-5, but this is a completely different thing. It's much more usable than an 86 or an MX-5 in that there are kind of usable back seats. But on top of that, this thing is so full of character. It's the kind of character we don't see anymore. And because of that twin rotor engine in the front, that makes this car so interesting. And it's a joy to drive even 19 years later. So in terms of answering those questions, yes, it can keep up with some modern sports cars. And if you buy it right, it's an absolute bargain today. And I highly recommend picking one up. If you're looking for something that is a joy to drive and full of character that we don't see anymore, this RX-8 is an incredible car.
Thanks for hanging out with me today and having a look at this 19-year-old 2004 Mazda RX-8, thanks to our pal Brian. Thanks, Brian. Anyway, hope you liked this episode, and if you did, you're not new to YouTube, you know what to do. Smash the subscribe button, turn on your notifications, like this video, and as always, sharing is caring, so please share this with your friends, especially on Reddit, because on Reddit, they really need to see reviews for drivers from drivers. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them in the comments below. I'll get back to you as soon as I can. And if you want to support the channel, please hit up our merch store. Links here, links below. Lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, including our very popular line of Save the Manuals merch, and Mazda still builds manuals. Anyway, thanks again for watching. We'll see you again next time. And remember, cars don't understeer by themselves, not even vintage Mazda RX-8s.